So now we talk about one of the bread and butter concepts of lung physiology, especially the first chapter. Right in the middle, he discusses that, okay, now we know the pressures of the pleural cavity. We know how the lung expands, how it contracts, all that thing. So now let's quantify air, shall we? How much air goes where? All of this is nicely and very easily stacked into volumes and capacities. So these are physical quantities of air that the lung can accommodate. Okay, what is the difference between, this is a bio question, what is the difference between lung and capacity, volume and capacity? Okay, very simple. Volume is one, capacity is when you add more than one volume to make one entity. That's capacity. So capacity is equal to multiple volumes, or volume is just one volume. So tidal volume we mentioned earlier. What is tidal volume? Amount of air that you inhale and exhale during rest, during breathing at rest. Okay. So now we will see what are the boundaries of the lung. So tidal volume is simple. Tidal volume is right now what the air that you are breathing. Not me, because I'm speaking. I'm putting in effort. But you at rest right now are inhaling 500 ml of air and exhaling 500 ml of air. But this is called tidal volume, T-I-D-A-L, tidal volume. It's a volume because it is just one entity. Yes? What if, I want to clarify something. What if I ask you to inhale deeply? So when you inhale deeply to the max, what happens? Is you inhale tidal volume air, obviously, and then, but you don't stop there. You really stretch it, okay, and inhale to the topmost level that you can inhale. Inhale, inhale, kencho, inhale to the max, pura. This is a capacity. Why? Because it is tidal volume plus whatever top volume that you accommodated, right? So adding both is a capacity. Is volume and capacity clear? What we mean by volume and what we mean by capacity? This is the simple stuff. That's it, thank you. Okay, so this diagram is from Guyton. This is a rather daunting graph, but it's very simple really. It's called a spirogram, okay? And just look at the red, yellow, pink, whatever, however you seeing it, curve. So this is a graph, look at this. This is inspiration, this is expiration. So, inspiration, expiration. This here, this volume, obviously volume is on the y-axis. This volume here is tidal volume. So amount of air that you take normally in and amount of air that you move out is tidal volume, depicted here by the vertical arrow, right here. Okay, now I asked you to stretch it. I asked you to inhale completely and fully, right? Don't do that right now. I'm reminding you that I did. This is that effort. So on top of tidal volume, you go here and now you stretch it. You pull it all in, okay? This bit here, this volume here, up and above the tidal volume to the max, is called inspiratory reserve volume. So inspiratory reserve volume is the volume of air that you can maximally expand your lung with on top of tidal volume. Okay? The whole thing. Now, when you add inspiratory reserve volume plus tidal volume, this arrow here, you make a capacity, it's called the inspiratory capacity. Okay, so the inspiratory capacity, in simple words, is the ability of your lung, individual lung, which depends on your height, depends on your weight, depends on the shape of your thorax. All thoracic cage is not exactly the same. So depending on your physique, your inspiratory capacity will vary slightly. Okay, but normally we will look at the values. Okay, so you understand what volumes and capacities are, right? Okay. Any questions? Now, look at what is happening in expiration. So in expiration, what is this? Then there's a big black bar here. So clearly something drastic is happening here, below this whole gray area or yellowish area. But when you expire during tidal volume, this is the point. However, now if you're asked to exhale as much air as you can possibly, that volume is called expiratory reserve volume. So beyond which you can't exhale anymore. That air sitting there at the end of a normal tidal volume expiration is called expiratory reserve volume. And whatever is left in the lung is your famous residual volume. Residual volume you can't touch. You shouldn't be able to touch. It's normal to have residual volume. You know one of the reasons. Okay? You know why there needs to be a certain amount of air in the lung at all times to prevent collapse, and hence the increased work of breathing, the nightmare work of breathing that you will have to endure while inspiring. Okay. What else? Look at this capacity. This is very important, guys. Not that that is also important, but this is a very important thing here. FRC. Remember we looked at FRC while studying the graph of compliance? There is a label called FRC, functional residual capacity. So functional residual capacity is basically expiratory reserve volume plus residual volume. In simple words, right now, you at tidal volume, whatever remains of air after a tidal volume expiration is FRC, your FRC. Right? What would happen to FRC in emphysema? But FRC you know, okay? Now, quickly, we have done tidal volume, inspiratory reserve volume, expiratory reserve volume, we have done inspiratory capacity, and we have done functional residual capacity, okay? What is left are two things. One is vital capacity. Vital capacity is actually the test when you go to a clinic to get your lungs checked. What the doctor asks you to do, the maneuver that he asks you to do, is actually vital capacity. What is vital capacity? Look at the graph. Look at what components it entails. It entails the inspiratory reserve volume, obviously the tidal volume, and the expiratory reserve volume. I'll give you a few seconds to work out what kind of maneuver can you do to do the vital capacity. You pull in maximum air and you push out maximum air. Vital capacity. Okay? If you do it slowly, it is just vital capacity. If the guy asks you to force yourself, pull in as much as possible and exhale by pushing the thing out. That is forced vital capacity. FVC. Forced vital capacity as opposed to vital capacity. In vital capacity, you pull in the air and you exhale at leisure, aram se, no issues. But when the doc asks you to push it, zor lagaye in exhalation, that maneuver is FVC, forced vital capacity, designed to get to catch the lung in expiration. Nahi, ye simple hai. We will talk about forced vital capacity. Because, very good question. Welcome. Jaldi, better here. Okay, so why don't you do it? Okay, I know you are wearing masks, but just pretend that you have inhaled completely. Do it. Inhale completely. Full. Now, fully exhale, but slowly. And completely. Niche tak leke jaye. Ho gaya? This is your simple vital capacity maneuver. Now, don't do it, but now whenever you are in open space, do the same maneuver, but in exhalation, expiring, push it. Zor laga, angry. Why would we do FVC? What are we looking for? I say we are looking for any structural damage of the lung. Total lung capacity is obviously when you add all of the volumes together. So this is just factors which affect what I was discussing, the posture, muscle strength, compliance, etc., your health, general health, your height, all of this affects these volume to a certain extent, okay? But standard books, the values that you will see are standardized 60 kg man, 70 kg man, okay, and of average height. So all of the volumes written in Guyton are of an average person, average American person, okay? Okay, why do we need to have residual volume? One thing was to conserve work of volume, do not have it, make it expensive, because collapsing it and then inflating would be a big issue. However, there's a second point which I've added to the video because I forgot at that time. The second point is, imagine what is the main function of the lung? Oxygenation and taking carbon dioxide out. If lung is collapsed after every expiration, what happens to the blood that is flowing in that time zone while the lung is collapsed? It will not be oxygenated and carbon dioxide will not be taken from it. So that piece of blood, that part of blood, will just go through the lung and go out and mix with your pure oxygenated blood and bring the whole building down. It will decrease the overall oxygen content of arterial blood. Yes, did you get that? So lung collapse is actually bad for two reasons. Yani residual volume is good for two reasons. One is it conserves your work of breathing. Number two, it maintains blood gases. Now, all of these volumes we can detect, measure using a lab equipment called a spirometer. You have been to physio lab, of course you have been. Have you noticed a big white drum that is placed there with all sorts of tubing coming out of it and there is water in it? It is a spirometer. I'm telling you, that's a spirometer. It's practical, it's coming up. Now, from spirometer, you can measure tidal volume, you can measure inspiratory reserve volume, and hence calculate what the inspiratory capacity is. Once these two volumes are known, then capacities can always be derived. You need to just worry about the volume, because capacities can be derived, right? Expiratory reserve volume you can also measure, okay, during that with that spirometer. What can't you measure? You can't measure residual volume directly using a spirometer. Why? Well, obvious, because that is the air that you can't move, you can't expire. What to do with it? You can't measure it directly. But the word is directly. There is another way. I'll show you the way. So whenever somebody asks you that, name the one volume that you can't, one volume and capacity, two capacities that you can't measure using the spirometer, and he does not mention directly or indirectly, your answer should reflect that directly we can't measure residual volume, and hence which two other capacities you can't measure? FRC and total lung capacity, TLC. Every calculation that has residual volume in it, you can't calculate because residual volume is sitting in there and you can't measure residual volume directly. Helium dilution method. Remember the formula C1V1 is equal to C2V2? Everyone knows this, okay? You must have dealt with it in chemistry lab. So if you have anything unknown, any volume unknown, but you have three parameters of these known, you can derive the fourth one. So C1 is known, V1 is known, C2 is known, you can derive V2. Obviously, mathematics, okay, bring C2 at the bottom, at the denominator of C1 and V1. V2 is, you find V2, right? Now, what has this got to do with the law? Everything. What do we do? Helium is a gas. Yes? Heard of helium? What's that? So what's interesting about helium is that it's not absorbed by the blood. So if you were to inhale helium, a little bit of helium, it will just stay in the lung. It will not cross the respiratory membrane into blood. Yes? Fact. It's a fact. So what you do is you inhale. So you connect the spirometer, and in the spirometer, you put a known amount of helium. Normally, when you breathe from the spirometer, they just put that mouthpiece in your mouth, seal it, and you breathe from the spirometer. So you're breathing air from the spirometer and expiring air into the spirometer. So you're not breathing now from the air. You're actually breathing from the spirometer in and out. Yes? But now, once you do the practical, you will absolutely clear itself. But now, this air of the spirometer has a known amount of helium in it. So now when you take breath one, it is air molecules with helium molecules going into your lung. Yes? What will happen after a few breaths to the helium, original helium concentration inside the spirometer? It will become diluted, because this is a chamber which did not have any helium. This was a chamber which had helium. You connect both chambers and allow equilibration between the two chambers by breathing in, out, in, out, in, out. So all that helium goes in, not all, but there is equilibration. So now you have helium here, and now you have helium here. Yes? So hence the word helium dilution method. So this is helium dilution method dedicated for good students in a while. The question will start with residual volume. You will be asked about its amount, 11 to 200 ml normally in a person. Now from here, the examiner may go into clinical directly, may ask what happens in COPD to the residual volume, and then take it from there, and then question, then another question, and so on and so forth. There is then the technique that I told you, that if you give certain keywords at the end, you can adjust the questions. Another way the examiner can go is ask you, how can you measure residual volume? This is only when you confidently and correctly answer all the basic questions. Then he or she may ask you, how do you measure residual volume? You say, directly we can't, indirectly we can. So this is one of the ways you can use spirometer with helium in it. The technique is called helium dilution method. There's another way, plethysmography. I won't cover it, it's not covered in your book. However, the really good students will probably have a look at them as well. Because look, in a viva, sometimes a very sweet spot comes with the examiner. When you connect with the examiner, and when you are answering in a way that examiner really appreciates, then he forgets that you are just a first year student. And he just gets interested in what else do you know. He or she becomes curious about you. Then good things come. So he may ask you, okay, helium dilution you know. Is there another way? There is another way. And you say plethysmography. Sir, I don't know exactly what plethysmography is. However, I do remember reading about sitting the person in a sealed chamber and getting him air through a mouthpiece connected with equipment outside. That's it. He's sold and you're out with very good marks. Anyway, with that logged away, helium dilution is explained in Guyton to a very small extent, and I will also restrict myself to that very small extent. We know what the setup is. Helium spirometer, us, and now the equilibration has happened. All you need to now remember is the amount of dilution of helium by the lung gives the clue of these secret volumes. So the air must have gone through the FRC, wouldn't it? Because it's like taking a highlighter and labeling text with it. What you have done is you've taken helium, inhaled it. Now helium is everywhere, isn't it? Helium is in the your tidal volumes. Helium is in the expiratory reserve volume. Helium is in the residual volume. It's everywhere, right? It has gone deep into the residual volume. It has labeled it as well. Now all you have to do is ask the guy to exhale. If he normally exhales at tidal volume, what is left behind? FRC. So now you are measuring the concentration of helium in his breath, and he has exhaled one tidal volume air. This will reflect the helium that is left behind in that whole FRC. And hence you can calculate FRC from the C1 V1 is equal to C2 V2 equation. What if you want to solve it for residual volume? What do you ask your guy to do? Exhale to the maximum. When this guy exhales to the maximum, the recorded helium tells you the picture of the only thing which is left behind, the residual volume. You solve C2 V2 is equal to C1 V1 C2 V2. For this concentration of helium, it gives you V2 is residual volume. So this is not invited. This is that setup before equilibration. Okay, you had helium in the spirometer, nil here. Okay, then you allowed equilibration. The dots are less here. They went in. Now the dots are sort of equal. Okay, it is all equilibrated in the lung, between lung and the spirometer. This is the equation. Okay, V2 here is actually V1 plus V2. You will not go into it. You have done this in your chemistry practicals, and it basically, I've already explained this whole thing. This is just a mathematical expression. Okay. This, however, I picked it from Guyton. So Guyton does not give the formula for residual volume calculation. However, it gives the formula for FRC calculation. So FRC calculation, this is from Guyton. This is concentration of helium initially, concentration of helium finally after equilibration, minus 1 multiplied by volume of the spirometer, the total volume of the spirometer. Okay. This gives you the FRC. This basically, to the trained eye, is this equation. He has just labeled it. It is exactly this simple equation. Okay. So maybe the quiz may give you a scenario which mentions FRC and asks you to calculate residual volume. Can you? From the question. Or if you are given TLC, can you calculate residual volume from this? Yes. We'll see. Okay. But with you guys, you're a good class in that sense. Okay. Going to the clinical side. Now everything will be with an F. Forced. Why are we looking at forced? And I have to say it. I thought I shouldn't. I'll ask you. But I have to, because I have to explain this. So, with emphysema, COPD patients, the problem with it is in expiration, yes? This, and we in the clinical setting, we need to quantify how messed up the lung is actually. We need to quantify it. We need to give it a number. Is it less than 80%? Is it less than 70%? Less than 50%? Less than 30%? Yani, we need to know in mathematical way how messed up the lung is, so that the management, the medication and whatever treatment we have to give this person can be adjusted accordingly. Okay, less than 50% or 30%, the guy needs to be admitted. He can't just be roaming around. He'll collapse and die somewhere. If he's between 80 to 50, okay, you can manage him as a outpatient person, okay, but with strict directions. So how does these values come about? So spirometer in the clinical side is not a big drum. It's actually a handheld device, very smart, digital, handheld device. We don't have it in the lab, but we have it in the hospital. And the patient actually puts the device, the mouthpiece of the device in and expires in it, and all sorts of graphical data comes through. Inspiration, expiratory curves, all of it comes. I cannot go into those graphs unless the class is interested. So I will give you the basic information. Again, this information, for some reason, Guyton does not give a lot about. But I think it's crucial that people are made aware of the clinical setting of spirometer. Because spirometer in the physio lab is like a village. It's very basic, very, very basic information. The spirogram that you saw is very, very kid stuff. Because when you go to the ward and to the section of the hospital dealing with respiratory diseases, pulmonology, you will find absolutely different values and terms that they use. These are those terms. So FVC is the term, not VC, forced vital capacity. You ask the patient to force expiration out. Why? Because you want to, with good intentions, you want whatever part of lung prone to collapse, because then it will show in the data that his FVC is at this level. If he doesn't force it, the structure won't collapse. So some patients are clever. When you ask them to expire, they expire slowly using the accessory muscles. When you use the accessory muscles and expire slowly, you still get the FVC in a decent level. But when you force it, by forcing it, you can't use the accessory. You can use the accessory muscles, but the pressure is so much that the damaged part just, it cannot remain open and it collapses. There, this is what you want. You want the guy to show you the collapsed portions. And the only way is through forcing the air. Hence, everything now will come with a force, forced vital capacity, forced expiratory volume. I'll tell you one. Okay? Then the ratio FEV1 over FVC. So everything is forced here. If there are no questions, I'll now delve into this. Okay? No questions. So FVC, forced vital capacities, this is the normal range. At 4.7 to 5 liters. So you are expected to process 4.7 to about 5 liters of air in and out in a vital capacity maneuver of the forced kind. A normal individual ranks between these two values, 4.7 to 5. No problem, well done. But even if the guy has COPD, it really is in the starting stages. If he's towards the lower end, lower normal end, history is that he smokes for such and such years, you suspect he may have COPD starting, but the FVC is showing that he's still in the normal range, however, tilted towards the lower end. So it's the thing is starting. So you go, in this patient, you go for your instinct. Right? The guy is certainly developing COPD, however, the test is not negative. Still, I need to counsel him and etc. etc. He needs to see smoking, whatever. This is where the money is. FEV1, and I will take my time here. Forced, expiratory, volume. This one is very important. This one is not 1 second. Okay, so it's second, 1 second. But it's not 1 second. You ready? It is the first second. But there is a hell of a difference between saying forced expiratory volume in 1 second and forced expiratory volume in the first second. So check this out. Patient is sitting here. He has the digital spirometer in his mouth. And I have asked him to inhale maximum. Saans pura andar khenche. Inhale deeply to the max. When he has done that, and I can see that he has done that, now I'll ask him, saans ko zor laga ke bahar nikal. Exhale maximally to the maximum that you can. Yes? As soon as he has stopped inhaling, the digital spirometer makes a graph and stops because he has stopped inhaling. So it has a separate curve for inhalation, separate curve for exhalation. I've actually drawn it in the air. Inhalation is above the x-axis, exhalation. So it's like this, inhalation, exhalation, in the digital variety. Anyhow, you don't need to worry about that. So as soon as the guy starts exhaling inside that meter, the machine picks it up that now air is coming in, right? It starts to make the expiratory graph. In the first second of when he started to exhale, the first second, a normal person should be able to empty 80% of the air that he took in. So normal lungs, elastic recoil and all that effort that we have now read is so healthy and nice and excellent, the recoil and everything, because everything is normal, the recoil is normal, that you get rid of, if you are asked to, by force, you are able to get out at 80% of that volume that you stored inside in that inspiratory effort in the first second. This is not just any 1 second. No. It is the first second. You may not catch him in a simple FVC maneuver. If the patient is clever, he does not want to be embarrassed in front of you. He knows that his lungs are messed up. Maybe. And he's educated. So he might maneuver it in a way that you can't catch him. But he can't escape FEV1. Because FEV1 is focused on the first second. So if he's slow about it, then the value of expiratory air in the first second will obviously be less. He has to push. So FEV1, if this is not the value or around this amount, so imagine of this whole thing, so for example, it's total FVC is 5. Out of 5, 3.8 liters need to exit the lung in the first second for the person to be normal, the lung to be normal. Yes, this is the power of the normal lung. So if he's falling short of that, either obstructive disorder or restrictive disorder. Yada theek hai? Finally, you make a ratio of it. FEV1 over FVC, if it's around 80% or 0.8, we are good. Anything less, we have a problem. Okay? Described it, we can study this now. Look at the graph. Graph is of expiratory air. So this is where you ask the patient to expire from, the start of the purple curve, right here. And this is how we expired. So initially, look at the curve here. Right up till here. This is the 1 second, 0 second, 1 second. Okay. This is the time frame during which 80% of the lung will empty. Look at the size of the graph and the curve. It's explosive. It really drops free fall till this point. And then it flattens out a bit because there's only 20% left. So that needs to be pushed out of the lung. Now solve this. This is the normal lung. This is a diseased lung. This is another diseased lung. This is data. If this is the expiratory curve, FEV1, FVC of a normal healthy lung, what is wrong with this graph and what is wrong with this graph? This is very close to what you will be doing actually in pulmonology. Very close. You'll be looking at graphs a lot. And you'll be so seasoned, inshallah, that you will just look at it and you will say, okay, ye disorder, ye group of disorder, it's restrictive or obstructive. So I've given you the hint now. One of these is an obstructive disorder, the other is a restrictive disorder. Which one and why is the whole point? This is an obstructive disease actually from asthma. This is the kind of graph that you get in an obstructive patient. This is a restrictive disorder. Classically, fibrosis, pulmonary fibrosis. Okay, so compare this graph in its magnitude, its shape, its distance from the top dotted line. Compare the amount of FEV1, the amount of FVC with this. Now that you know what it is, compare it. So the guy was an asthmatic. We asked him to exhale with force. What happened? His airways got constricted, got crushed. I've been explaining since morning. What happened? His FEV1 is nothing compared to a normal person's FEV1 for this reason. Yes? The total FVC is of course nowhere near the normal person's FVC either. So, hear this out. The amount of air that he can breathe out in the first second is very low, and also the total amount of air that he can get out of the lung is also low. These are two different things. The FEV1 describes to you the recoil capability of the lung, which reflects the health of the lung, the normal tissue of the lung. The total FVC gives you a hint towards where that inspired air went, because he obviously hasn't taken it out. They haven't given the top graph. The top, he was asked to inhale, fully inhale and then exhale. But if the FVC is just this, and it's supposed to be this long, 5 liters, but he has just been able to give out about a measly 3 or 3.5, where is the rest of the volume going? It's staying inside. So I've answered my own question. What happens to residual volume in obstructive disorders? The data is here. Check out the restrictive disorder though. It's peculiar. Look at the shape of the graph. Wouldn't you say, look, in obstructive, the shape of the graph is totally messed up. But look closely to the restrictive wala graph. Wouldn't you say that it is a miniature of the normal lung? Sort of, close. Restrictive is, obstructive is nowhere near the normal shape of the graph. However, restrictive is close. What is that one word that we always used for restrictive lung disorder, wali lung? That it is a stiff lung. Now the problem with stiff lung is that it is difficult to expand, easier to expire. So, quick question. If I'm calculating FEV1 over FVC, the ratio, for a restrictive lung, I say that it will come to around normal. How come? I'll leave that question. I'll repeat that question, but I'll leave it with you. For a restrictive lung, if I calculate FEV1, it will be less. If I calculate FVC, it will be less. However, when I put them together, they will come out to be, say it, normal. And hence, again, we have answered both will be decreased. The ratio will be the same. It will come around 0.8. But don't be thrown off by the ratio. Always go for individual values. Look for FEV1 data. What is FEV1? If it's around 3.8, then it's fine. If it's not, then you have a problem. Either of the obstructive kind or the restrictive kind. See here? But the basic differences are these. Then the pattern comes out. Is it obstructive or is it restrictive? Rule of thumb, everything is less in the restrictive kind. Because, why? Shabash. Very good. Very good. Wait, 2.5 students are understanding everything. Same. Inspiration. In restrictive disorders, you can't really inhale either, can you? So everything will be less. Inhalation will be less. FEV1 will be less, FVC will be less, everything is less. But the ratio comes out a champion because everything is equally less. So ratios is fine, but don't go for the ratio, go for the values. किसमें? हाँ, because no, when you compare it with the normal, compare it with the normal. Look at where the normal is. It really dips down, and compare it now. No, the total volumes are very less in restrictive. Either. I asked you to compare it with the normal. This is the normal, and look at the values. Right? This is here. Now check this out. This is right here. So the shape might be all right, but it's really skewed upwards. Okay.